We have a very illustrious panel of speakers with us. Belinda Wright was supposed to join us, but for some reason she is not there. And we have equally good person with us, Lisa Mills. May I invite you, madam? Please. Yeah, Lisa Mills is from Montana University. For many years, she has been working with communities in elephant conservation. I will ask her later on to speak for half a minute about herself. Then I have with us Biswajit Mohanty. Biswajit Mohanty from Orissa. He has not, okay. So we have Ranjan Borthakur. Ranjan Borthakur from Green Guard Nature Organization, India. Please welcome. He will also speak. Then we have Mr. Jayanta Kumar Das. He is also from the trains. And he will also introduce himself. So let us start with a little bit of an introduction of ourselves. So may I hand over the mic to Lisa Mills.
Hi. There's no way I could fill the shoes of Belinda Wright, but they asked me to join the panel. So here I am. I'm with the University of Montana. I'm also involved in a project called Certified Elephant Friendly Tea, and an organization that, well, a corporate organization that we've started called Elephant Origins. So basically, we're going to marry driving change with enterprise and really try a new model of conservation. So I'll tell you about that a bit on a panel tomorrow, but today I just want to focus a little more on work with communities that we've done with elephant conservation.
Good evening, everybody. It's amazing to be here, particularly with these three old colleagues of me, Dr. Sharma, Lisa Mills, and another here sitting there, Pranjal Besbura. Very nice. Myself, Jayanta Kumar Das. Basically, I'm a reporter of the Assam Tribune, and also work as the honorary wildlife warden of Assam, and have been working in the field of elephants conservation, specifically human-elephant conflict in Indo-Bhutan border area since 2013. And I am very fortunate to have with us Lisa Mills, Dr. Sharma, Pranjal Besbura. They have been with us. Thank you. Thank you so much.
Mr. Bhatt.
Good evening. My name is Ranjan Kumar Borthakur. I am from Green Guard Nature Organization, and I have been dealing with human elephant conflict matter since last 2004, and I have been in the field of conservation, biodiversity conservation, since 1997.
Thank you. The topic that the objective of our this panel discussion is to explore ideas and solutions to conserve Asian elephants and integrate community development with Asian elephant conservation. So basically, the primary target in our discussion is the community. But we all accept the fact that we have an interface, what behind the scene we say conflict. We have a lot of conflicts with the elephants. And in that situation, how the community will survive and how the elephants will survive as well. Now, I understand that elephants are just the role model or the idols of the wildlife. Basically, when we say elephants, there were some papers, I was listening to that. It is not just elephants. Actually, we are talking about the entire wildlife. So very recently there was a news from WWF that more than 60% of the mammal have already gone extinct, and there was another prediction that by 2026 most of the mammals except the human beings will be wiped out, all wildlife will be wiped out. So that is the situation in our hand. We all understand that we are in a biodiversity hotspot. we have many other diverse flora and fauna in this region. So this is the right place to have a discussion. Discussions we do in air-conditioned rooms, but we have to work in the field. And very happy to see there are many persons like Pankaj Sharma, who's whole of his life been working in the field, and our friend Raj, and many others whose name I don't know, but you are here because you have interest in conservation. Raj spoken, yes. Sometimes, like, I go on to the villages and meet the children and try to, you know, indoctrinate them into the conservation situation. Then they ask, uncle or sir, why we need to conserve elephants? They do not plow our field, nor they give us milk. Why we need to conserve them? Now villagers would say that elephants only come and destroy our fields, our livelihood, kill our family members. So, but the other side is that in spite of all this negativity associated with conservation, we are sitting in a region which is credited with one of the most dense population of wildlife in general, and elephants in particular. We have 5,700 wild elephants in the forest of Assam, which is so depleted forest. We have about 1,200 captive elephants as well. And one forest officer of this region, P.D. Stracy, many years back, he predicted that if elephants survive anywhere, it will be in Assam. So the people of Assam are still permissive to the elephants. But then, at the same time, we cannot sit complacent. We know that the elephants are threatened. But at the same time, because I am also a doctor, you know, I mentioned something that the children ask why we need to conserve them. There are many reasons why we need to conserve not only elephants, every flora and fauna that exists. Nothing exists here without a reason. So for elephants, I say a few things. One is that elephants promise us to give an answer against cancer. Probably many of you have not heard about it. There is the P53 gene has, there people were predicting that because elephants do not have cancers. Why? It's such a huge animal. Every other species have cancers, elephants do not. So they have P53 gene, and now they have isolated one leukemia inhibiting factor in the P53 gene of elephants. See, the answers are there in nature. So we need to conserve, and we do not know today. Maybe our knowledge is not adequate today, but maybe within 5 years or 10 years, we'll know those facts. But at the same time, we have to support, we have to make our rural community survive. So can I ask Lisa, like, what is your idea? How should we, the wildlife conservationist community as a whole, and particularly the forest department, like, or the government, what kind of thing they should do so that the human elephant can coexist, that we can avoid the word conflict, we can use the word human elephant coexistence?
That's a big question, but from my experience in just since 2010, when I lived in Bhutan, I started to work with Bhutan villagers and teachers on an educational program, and then we spread to a transboundary region to work with Assam communities. And so to both Jayanta and Dr. Kike Sarma and Pranjal, Dr. Besbarwa here, are all worked on the Elephants on the Line project. And I think we learned a lot about what could be done when you basically organize people. So Jayanta coordinated the Uldagiri district group and really pulled together the community. 120 volunteers or so were basically working very hard to help support communities when there was conflicts happening. And so sending out rapid response to the community to support them when there's conflicts, to engage with the Forest Department and support the Forest Department, who was often blamed for the elephant conflicts, but yet in reality they're understaffed, and what could they really do when elephants don't have enough resources themselves to survive? You know, elephants are eating like 18 out of 24 hours a day, and there's not enough. And of course, they're going to be attracted to crops and so on. So I think Jayanta and Dr. KK Sarma can speak about the elephants on the line experience. But I want to bring up something that is newer that I worked on since that time that I think might have some potential. And it came from my learnings of just all of you all working with communities and watching what was happening. When you basically organize people to put their heads together and think about solutions, change begins to happen. I'll never forget the time we went after houses were knocked down in the night, after watching a line of people chasing elephants and harassing them, and that night the village, several homes were damaged in the same location. By morning, a group went in and did an educational program with school kids, and the kids reenacted what happened and came up with solutions, ideas. Those children, little children, came up with the idea themselves that all those people shouldn't have been harassing the elephants in the first place, and they acted out this idea that they would plant a place for the elephants to go with a little forest. And that was their solution. Little school children came up with this, and the parents were watching from that village. They were watching on while the children themselves came up with these ideas. And you remember that day, you came along. And it was really enlightening to me, and I thought, I think the education of youth and changing the dynamic so that they realize, habitat protection is not going to be easy. When you're living on the edge and you need more firewood, you're going to get it and you're going to survive as a family. But I also say I'm watching what's beginning to happen with the Balapara Foundation that kind of followed from this Elephants on the Line project, and that is the tree plantings and engaging communities. It's expensive to do. It takes time. Not every tree is going to grow and survive. There's going to be a lot that don't make it. But you know, where there are patches of potential habitat where you could remove the weeds, let the jungle grow back, get things going, engage the community. My concern now is livelihood. I don't know if it's easy for people to dream big if they're in a survival mode all the time. So I'm just going to leave it with one last little thing we've begun to do, just as an experimental project. It's actually Mike Korchinski here in the office, in the audience. His organization, the Wildlife Friendly Enterprise Network, put a little bit of cash into this project, and it's basically to create a pilot where we gave women, they gave some money for this, and I gave my time, okay, from University of Montana, to, and we engaged a farmer, Tenzing Bedoza, who you'll meet tomorrow night, to train up some women to run a plant nursery. So they're planting native trees, and then they're selling those trees for a project for reforestation. And the women basically are using the money to pay back. So it's a micro loan program where they have their own business now, a nursery business. They can sell the trees, make a little money, pay themselves back, and bring more women into that project. So improving livelihood for some women that are in vulnerable situations. And I could see the potential of doing projects like that. So I'd like to offer up that sometimes a little bit of well-planned support at the beginning can lead to great things. And already we're seeing those trees and the plantings beginning to attract more people wanting to support these kinds of projects. And yet they're not, they're very small in scale. So school children are now taking the trees that the women grew and are planting them along the Bhutan-India border in a little reforestation area. And just that whole act of the children planting those trees, I think, is where the change is really happening. That's now their forest, you see? And I think that's what I'd leave it with, is change people by engaging them in whatever way, no matter how small scale. I think that's going to have the biggest ripple effect of all. And just do that across many places. Like Elephants on the Line did a great job, but the funding ended. So how do you keep something going is what concerns me. We need those solutions.
Thank you, Lisa. And what you have been saying is excellent. Because most of the time when we have this kind of academic discussions, because I told you I am in this field for over 3 decades, these days I cannot hold on my enthusiasm. Most of the time I feel these are just futile exercise, we are just passing time, some meeting has to be held and we are holding, nothing is transformed into the field, and basically we all know this is competition for space. This area, northeastern region in general and Assam in particular, was very sparsely populated. We had just 1 crore people, and now we are 3.5 crore. The population has grown both vertically, horizontally, influx of people from neighboring countries, and like politically motivated transmigration of people, settling people in the forest. So we all know that the animals need space to survive. So do the human. If you allow the human population to grow and come from all over the world and settle here, this land is very fertile, of course, but there is a limit, the threshold limit is crossed, so the conflict. And we find no lasting solution. We are fighting. But as he said, small things, firefighting type. We know overnight we are not going to find any solution. We are firefighting here and there. Anyway, today we have a man, Jayanta Das, and so I told him that you are living in the trends. I said, why in the trends? Because you are in the front line. He is in Udalguri district, highest human-elephant conflict taking place in Udalguri district, highest human casualty, so also on the elephant side. Almost the entire forest, the natural forest is wiped out, and he sees elephants every day. He covers the news, wildlife news in Assam Tribune. There was a paper that Assam Tribune gives a very like balanced view, no bias view. They give a very balanced view. They give the news generally, very less views. And Jayanta Das is here. So a man in the front line, in the trenches. So we want to hear his thoughts. Like how he can, like what is his suggestion that both community development as well as the elephant conservation can go side by side? What's his perception?
Thank you, Dr. Soma. Thank you, Lisa Mills. What we have been discussing right now, we have been doing this for years. In various places, in hotels, Delhi, Mumbai, Kolkata, whatever it is, we have been discussing this technical, we have been trying to find technical solutions and how to control or mitigate this human elephant conflict. These things have been a regular phenomenon nowadays. Even in the newspaper, we have been reading this. So many people have been giving so many reasons, but Dr. Soma rightly says, I live on Indo-Bhutan border area, and have been working there since 2006. So we have earned a lot of experience there, meeting people daily, meeting hundreds, more than 100 and 150 elephants still is there in my district. So I just don't want to discuss this technical so-called causes or other things, but I want to tell you these things, people are here, present here. So I want to tell you, as requested by Dr. Soma, to say some other things. So some positive things I am going to tell you, but these have been not noticed by government or department or whatever it is, but still we can see hope hanging, okay? So some points I'll be happy to share with you. Number one, it is a very good thing that there is no elephant poaching, unlike rhino, in Assam. Am I right, Dr. Sir?
By and large.
Because from my area, the poaching is very below 10%. It is all other because of the conflict. Okay? So this is a first good thing that elephants are not being killed for tax. due to retaliation, due to some other reasons, due to deforestation, and other things, and these things have been going on. So, and one interesting thing I want to tell you, this media, just now there is a session on media. So, some lady was talking on this. So I am also from a media fraternity, but also working in there. Yeah. But from my experience, 12 or 13 years experience in the field, I tell you, these herds of elephants, they are not coming down to Assam from Bhutan or Arunachal or Nagaland for food and shelter. So every time we see a casualty or anything in the newspaper, we just write, there are these herds of elephants coming down to plains of Assam looking for food and shelter. That is not exactly the right answer. Because, you know, because I am actually feel some awkward position because some top expert is sitting beside me. So I am very much afraid of speaking right now. Still, I think I should share my experiences. Okay? So if anything I say wrong, I request immediately to rectify or correct it. So, you know, these elephants, they are not stationary. They move 600 to 700 kilometers in a year. They cannot stay in a single place or district or country. So in this way, this elephants has in Assam, particularly this districts bordering Arunachal and Bhutan, this is a different situation. So what happens? The herds of elephants, first time in a 100 to 150 numbering, they come down to Assam. When? June, July, August, September, this season. We call this seasonal migration. We call. So they are coming here in the summer season, rainy season, they are coming down to plains. There are enough food, shelter there in Bhutan and Arunachal. Still, they are here. Why? Because it is the time they deliver babies. So it is not suitable for Arunachal Forest or Bhutan hills. That is very difficult terrain. So they come down to plains. And interestingly, I have already told you that they used to travel 700 plus 600 to 700 kilometers in a year, these animals. So where will they go? Definitely they follow some traditional routes. That we call elephant corridors. Okay? Even Dr. Sharma some few years back told me, I can remember, this unlike human beings, elephants, they have some genetic transformation. They can navigate whenever or wherever their forefathers, ancestors had been. So the faint or vague recollection or memory with this they navigate, their next generation try to visit these places. And so they come down to these old areas. And what happened? The areas have been already encroached, occupied by people. Even if you go to Indo-Bhutan area, international border, there is human settlement in the international borderline. So elephants cannot come. This way, conflict is on still. So time is very short. I must make it very short. So my assumption is, my idea is, it is impossible to stop or end this human-elephant conflict in the world, or India, or in Assam. You cannot control it. You cannot check it. You know, these people, daily so many people have been dying in bike accident, road accident, train accident, plane crash. So many people have been dying. There are so many cases of rapes, steal, robbery, killing. Can any government stop it? No. No government in the world can stop this. So this conflict, human or animal, especially these wild elephants, it will be continued. There will be always conflict. But what we can do, we can minimize it. But how? That is, I am speaking from my experience, field experience. So you cannot pass any order. You cannot shoot. You cannot pass order to shoot all the 5,700 elephants. Problem will be solved. So we cannot do that. But what we can do to teach people, to aware people, tell people about the animal behavior, how they react with people, or what should be done or what should not be. recently in my district, very recently in this month, four people have been killed or died. How? Two instances I know very well. It is a last fortnight it was happened. One girl and one is with his boyfriend, at it was 10:30 p.m. We're walking through this elephant corridor near a river bank. And they knew that elephants were there, but still they find that is the most suitable place not to be seen by others. And as a result, they fall in front of the elephant, and boy ran out, and the girl was killed. So whose fault was this? So definitely humans. But it is the duty of the government, it is the duty of us, NGO societies, to teach people, tell people, this should not be done. We should not venture into this their area, to trespass their area. Second, last week, another people have been killed by one elephant. This week. What happened? In the morning at 5 a.m., he was going to his garden to pluck teas. It is in the tea garden area. So in the morning and evening, it is the very difficult time. So it was unfortunate he ventured out in the tea garden for plucking teas and was being killed. So now we are very much clear. I know from my 15, 16 years long experience, one way to teach people, tell people what should be that, what should not. If we award them, if we tell them right thing, then we can live together. One, two, that deaths will be there always, like I mentioned, this train accident, bus accidents, people, even brothers are killing brothers, like this. So casualty will be there, but it will be minimal. So that is the number one suggestion from myself, to tell people to do accordingly elephant friendly. Okay? And some other measures, because time is, can I?
Yeah, we should.
Okay, okay.
Okay. Then it becomes a little bit lively. Okay. Anyway, so you have made a very good point that education of the people, or no, I will come back. So educating the people not to do such things that make their life vulnerable. Like there are many other things, people brew country liquor, and the elephants are attracted by the smell. And some drunken people move at night without fearing they become victim. So such things, if like we can tell the people and like sensitize them not to do such stupid things, I think many more lives will be saved. Mr. Bhattacharya has also been working in the conflict mitigation. So I also want to hear his opinion about it, like how we can conserve the elephants. At the same time, we can also support the like the farmers, the rural livelihood.
So human-elephant conflict is basically a conflict of interest. Human and elephant is fighting for food and space. And there is definitely less space for elephant. Elephant habitats are destructed. As I have said, I am working with the human-elephant conflict matter in the bordering areas of Naugaon and Karbi Anglong district. And it is a part of the Burhapara hill range, which is contiguous to the Kaziranga Karbi Anglong Elephant Reserve. And when we first addressed this problem in 2004, we started with giving logistical support to the local communities, like distributing blankets and kerosene and torchlights, etc., to earn their trust on us. Because if we want to implement any kind of project relating to wildlife conservation, the support of the local community is a must. So that way we started. Thereafter we installed one tripwire system, early warning system, as we called it. It is a system we use fishing thread and calling bell It's a very simple system, and whenever elephant come and touch the fishing line, fishing thread, the alarms started buzzing, and the people, the guards that protect their paddy field, they come to know that elephants are coming, and even they can know from which direction. And thereafter, we started another effort, the hedge fencing, which is the plantation of that one particular kind of lemon species, and citrus lemon, and sadly that did not work because it needs lots of attention and management, and thereafter we implemented that mixture of it's a kind of a mixture of rice husk and the chili powder, and but that also did not work. And my suggestion is that without the economic upliftment of the local communities, our efforts will be go to vain, because they cannot afford any kind of damage, any kind of loss to their property, as it may be their houses or as it may be their paddies. So upliftment of their economic situation is very important. And another thing recently we are facing is electrocution of elephants. It is because some 8 to 10 years back there were some incidents of elephant electrocution, and the DC Nogaon formed a joint investigation team of NGOs, Forest Department, and Electricity Department, and we surveyed the areas for low-hanging wires, and that worked well. And 7 to 8 years there were no electrocution reports, but recently for 3-4 years we have noticed that intentional electrocution is there. People are killing elephants intentionally, and they use live wires to protect their households and their crops. So we noticed one thing, that as electric fencing is nowadays very common, Forest Department and other NGOs are deploying electric fencing to different areas, and if a village is protected by electric fencing, the people of another village is like to copy the same thing without knowing the technical know-hows. They just use live wires to protect their property, and elephants are dying. So as Sarmada said, awareness is must, and economic upliftment, if we have many different projects that government already running, but they are not reaching the proper place and proper people. If we can confirm that the projects can run go to in those areas, then I think the problem can be solved.
Thank you. Can we take some question or suggestion from the hall? Pankaj Sharma is there, is very experienced forest officer, now divisional forest officer of wildlife of Tezpur. Pankaj, there is an observation. Recently, there was a question, like a mention of a person who lives near elephant area. He told me, sir, every female has a calf. He has seen the elephants in the tea garden where they are very much exposed. You can really see. He said that, sir, every elephant has a calf. Now, he said the elephant population is increasing. Your statistics of the department shows there is a marginal increase, whether that is a real increase or just that is another thing. But I answered that it is possible. Actually, whenever a species threats, like perceives a threat that we are endangered, we have like we have to face the people, and we have always have the fight with them. So under this stress condition, the reproductive ability increases of every species, even some human species, human race. You will find out when they are threatened, the number of children are too many. Unknowingly, they do it. And wild animals, particularly when they are stressed, they increase their number. So what is your observation? Like their numbers are increasing? My logic may not be a realistic logic, but I felt it could be. Because our elephants are very much in conflict. As we are suffering, they are probably suffering much more than us. So is it possible that their the reproductive ability is increasing? What do you see in your areas?
I
introduce him. He's Mr. Pankaj Sharma.
I'm a forest officer. For the last 28 years, I'm the forest department working in the wildlife.
Yes,
thank different you. Areas of what? I'm at the verge of retirement. I'll retire after 3 years. Anyway, I joined my department in 1986. Since then, I'm getting this sort of a short-term conservation discussion. I've heard this discussion many years. And this number of population increasing, you can tell better than me, because the stress animal can breed better or not, I don't know. But one thing is sure, the people's opinion on an elephant herd. So counting of the animal is not possible for a normal person because they are a chase of the animal or they are being chased. But who counts? We forester counts. So I do not want to go to a controversial figure whether
no, there is a we want to
trend or
just a general trend. What the, because you are in, for 30 years you have seen.
Yes,
do you see
in decreasing trend?
Okay.
Pardon?
Decreasing.
You see, where I have served 15 years back, I am posted in the same area as an incharge, little bit on a higher post. 12 years back, the forest water has failed. Today, it will vanish. Where the elephant will go? Where you used to see the elephant at the meat place next to the road, there is human being. The elephant cannot cross because they have put electric fencing. Even one of my guys died a few days back, last month. So this is the stretch animal is happy. And there is a simple corridor. From the Namarin National Park, the elephant crossed the river, comes to the Balipur in the forest, a small area is left up. That is to fence now. At 12 o'clock, you can see the herd of elephants standing in the road. And day for yesterday, a report has came up, the elephant moving through the corridors, coming from Namiri, going through the Balipur River forest. Is it a corridor? It is a habitat.
Habitat.
So this is the conflict we are facing. But we are talking about the short-term measures for so many years. But nobody is talking.
Nobody.
Government is not taking it for planning, making it planning for the long-term measures.
Thank you, Sharma. Actually, I just wanted to hear you or the fact from the horse's mouth. Because that is the fact, the elephant population is actually not increasing. That is what I wanted to hear from you. Because wherever you go, people say that elephant population is increasing, what the government is doing, what the forest department is doing. The fact is, it's not increasing. They become more visible.
They become more visible.
Yeah.
They are more visible to human beings.
It's simple.
It cannot go increase. It cannot be increase in such a stress condition where there is no water outside.
Yes.
They are being chased.
Yes. People are sowing ages.
Even like when they have a calving, like generally when they have a calf in the middle of a village, you know the young calf, the newly born calf cannot walk away with the mother before 3 days. But people have no patience. They will be throwing pebble and crackers and everything. they don't want to consider what will happen to that calf. So quite often we get such young calves stranded or left behind. We know how many elephants are dying because of electrocution, and many more are dying in malicious poisoning. Malicious poisoning. And somebody mentioned about the Dipor Bill. I remember 11 elephants died since this line was laid. So that
in 2001 in Sunilpur district we have lost 31 elephants.
These are all
poisoning.
Yeah.
11 died inside my park.
Yes. So I was the unfortunate man who made the diagnosis. Yes. This was Dimecron.
And I was the man who went and
you were accompanying me.
So how many elephants are there left in the center?
So it's a record. It's 5,700.
5,700.
Approximately.
Actually, miscounting is there because the elephants we count, Meghalaya also counts, Bhutan also counts, like because we are not counting at the same time.
So that white paper that was published by Dr. Yadav,
not very white.
620 elephants.
That may not be very white.
Sharma, here I want to say.
Yes,
that.
Yes, please.
Actually, so many years, of 28 years, I have seen this short-term measures. Now somebody should come up with a bold decision and ask the government to take some long-term measures. Until unless we do not recover these areas, do not restore the areas, this solution never will be. These short-term measures we have to continue year after year. Somebody has to take a
couple of years back I heard Billy Arjun Singh, must have heard of him. He says that, yeah, the government of our country will listen to the wildlife if only they are given the right of voting. You know that. So that is the situation. People, the politicians will only care for the, electorate. The elephants do not vote. So
here
they have to suffer.
He spelled out different thing in other discussion. He said that you have to motivate the people in town in a different way, in the village in a different way. So we have to congregate our fraternity of the NGOs together, motivate them and go to the government.
It will be a very big task, but that initiative is required.
But
it is very late. It is very late.
28 years gone discussing.
It is gone.
This
same thing we are discussing. That is why at the very beginning I said, I feel very less enthusiastic, least enthusiastic these days to discuss these things, because 30 years we have been discussing the same thing, firefighting mechanisms.
So even the party which has the elephant as a symbol doesn't survive.
Nobody. I once in a big, where many political parties were there, the senior forest officials were there, I declared that I represent the elephants. And I beg that give me one forest at least, one place, maybe Nordua Reserve Forest, a 200 square kilometer forest, now not a single tree stands there. The whole of the northern band, like on the west, the Somcoast to up to the eastern part of the Lakhimpur district, bearing Nameri and partly Manas, no forest exists there. So they become very visible and they are always in conflict. They have no place to go. So we are so-called panelists, what new thing we will say? Nothing. So that is why I want a very open discussion among everybody. Everybody should speak and, yes.
I just want to ask, there's this Project Elephant in India, that's a government initiative. Can you tell us, is there anything that comes from that at all that would be a lightning rod for discussing this bigger issue?
Unfortunately, I'm also a member of the Project Elephant Steering Committee. But I'm a member of Project Elephant Steering Committee. I attend those meetings. I do not see much sincerity, whatever government has been there. And moreover, you know that the tiger situation was very bad. And then maximum emphasis has been given to the National Tiger Conservation Authority. Our Prime Minister is the chairperson. So funds also all goes to the NTCA. The elephant, though it has been declared as a heritage animal, and I say that while conserving elephant, we not only conserve elephant, we conserve everything. So the emphasis should be there. When you conserve elephant, tigers will also be conserved. But then who is there to listen. So the Project Elephant now has a very limited budget. They have the elephant reserves, but only in the paper, nothing in the ground. So that is the situation. But still they are working. But as per the expectation, actually it is not up to the expectation. Sir, you want to say?
Yes. I was wondering what percentage of poaching cases can be attributed to commercial ivory trade?
Fortunately, not much in Assam, because most of our bulls are makhanas. The poacher, the taskers have been wiped out many years back. Even during the British time or later on, the taskers are not there. Our bulls are mostly makhanas, so that is not. Though he mentioned that the poaching is very less. Unfortunately, in some parts of this region, poaching happens, very limited poaching for meat. There are people who consume elephant meat. There is a disturbing news in the Myanmar border. Now, in China, they have started preparing some fancy bags from elephant skin. So carcasses have been discovered in Myanmar, or the skin removed. So ivory is not a big issue here. It is in South India. Our bigger issue is actually this poisoning, as Pankaj Sharma has mentioned, electrocution, train hits, then to some extent this the tea garden ditch, the young calves fall there. Sir, you wanted to say something?
Yeah, but I mean, after you're done.
No. It is an open discussion.
Okay. So the first thing is that yes, ivory is a small issue, but not anymore. China is reconsidering. In fact, it has already kind of again opened up the market in a way.
Fortunately, what I said, fortunately, our males are not taskers. No. Our males are mostly, our means I am talking about Assam, our males are mostly makhana.
No, I understood. But so that's one part. Another thing is that tiger conservation is not hogging the money out of elephant conservation. I'll give you statistics. The overall wildlife budget of the country, which is basically 770 national parks and sanctuaries of India, the overall budget is a little over $250 million. Yeah, which in Indian currency it is 1,800 crores. One home of say one flat in Bombay, in a suburb, will cost you about 2.5 to 3 crores. 1,800 crores for 700 parks, which means every park, and many parks are more than 2,000 square kilometers. You are actually, if you divide it, it is only 2.5, so 25 million Indian rupees is being allocated by the center to protect all these reservoirs of water and biodiversity. So we have a problem right there. Tiger conservation gets some money, but that's also not 1,000 crores. So elephants are much larger. Their ranges are at least 10 times more than that of a tiger. And so the amount of money that they should get is proportional to that.
Yes.
So I think the good thing is at least they have some money for tigers, because most of our tiger habitats are also elephant habitats.
No, we appreciate that.
No, I'm not arguing on that, but I'm giving the perspective so that people understand that the focus has to be at the center, but the pressure has to come up from all these various states. And because
yes,
elephants are right now being pushed by states into the neighboring state, because this is not my problem. So Maharashtra state says, I get Karnataka elephants, I don't want them. Or Chhattisgarh gets 240 elephants because Jharkhand and Odisha have degraded their forest there. So it's elephant is now nobody wants to own it. And we are in a situation where this population of 30,000, which I feel is bloated for the very reasons that you have said, every state counts the same elephant because they have a range of about 2,500 square kilometers. So even if the population is 20,000, I don't think we either have the attitude nor the vision to safeguard these animals. So I think there will be a drastic decline in the population within the next decade.
Thank you very much. Actually, when you speak to a person on the street, his perception is that elephant population is increasing. That is the common people perception. And we know the reason, as he has already said, they are becoming more and more visible. And second thing, maybe little correction, because it's not only the central fund by which the national parks and other things are managed. For example, Kaziranga. Yeah.
The salaries come from the state.
Yeah, salary and other components come from the state. Some project mode fund comes from the center. But I agree, in the elephant area, and overall in the conservation area, fund allocation is much less.
So, we say we don't have money for the salaries. So, for a park like Pake, which is 700 square kilometers, there are only 14 permanent positions. 6 guards, 6 deputy rangers, and that's all. So, most of these parks are run by temporary laborers. So, the state is allocating, but they don't want to increase the number of people. Yes. They are still thinking that the animal population is like it was in 1960. However, the population is now 10 times more than that. So, they need to expand. So, both states and the center are shortchanging it.
Exactly.
So that's the problem. So they cannot pass the buck anymore because both of them are.
But in this situation, it will be the people and people initiative. That because basically the government has to be pressurized to allocate more fund and give more of, like for example, Kaziranga, we have a very good staff now. It only happened because of the public pressure. Like you remember, this present government came and conservation of rhino was one of the topmost agenda. Topmost. Anybody else wants to say something?
Yeah.
Yes, please, sir.
There's a simple point here. It's one thing to ask for more money from the government. Actually, we should ask them to spend less money to destroy these things. That's what the real problem is.
Yes.
And all these places, whether it is elephants or whether it is tigers or for that matter, whether
any
of these animals, there is a sort of misconception between not just government, but economists, governments, corporate sector. What they believe is that, oh look, we've done such a wonderful job, we've protected Kaziranga. But they built a dam upstream, which is going to flood Kaziranga daily up and down, the way it used to be flooded winter and summer.
Sir, you are very right. Actually, all of us have some responsibility.
Those are the real issues.
Yes, yes. Sir, if you recall, I think some 1 year back, there was an eviction drive in the Amchang Wildlife Sanctuary. It is just less than 1 kilometer from here. You can see Amchang Wildlife Sanctuary. In front of my eyes, because I have been living here for 40 years, it was a beautiful forest with, you know, diversity of wildlife and things. Encroachment started, and in front of everybody, nobody protested, encroachment was going on. And when some of the NGOs have gone to the court, the High Court repeatedly ordered that the encroachment should be removed. So finally, this government, present government of Assam, they started eviction drive. In just 2 days, the media has created such a, you know, emotionally surcharged situation that government had to withdraw. And just following that, there was a talk show in a television program. And so again, media was saying the elephants is coming out to the middle of the Guwahati city, what government is doing this, that. I said, what role you have played? When the government started the eviction, you emotionally blackmailed and you have stalled the eviction drive. You want to have the apple, eat it too. You cannot do two things. And you said there is a word called Khilanjia, local. Now, I said that local in the forest is only the vegetation and the animals. No indigenous people or anything, anybody can be a local in the forest. The local is the jungles and the animals. Now you go and you settle local people there, and animals are now loitering in the city. The one elephant has gone to the residence of the even the Hiteshwar Shakya sir's residence also visited.
He went to the right place.
I am telling you, one interesting thing regarding this Amchang eviction is there.
Look.
I should tell. There are 25 numbers of senior reporters, they live there. They purchase land or arrange land. So whenever they are in trouble, they started this publishing this news.
Yes, sir. And they, you know, thanks to the High Court, but finally, they have also surrendered. What to do with this?
Sir.
We want to end up. Yes, thank you very much. So this was a lively discussion. And as I said in the very beginning, there is no end for 30 years. I am involved with this. I am losing enthusiasm. So just to make it a little lively, I wanted to involve everybody. Because this is an issue everybody thinks sometimes. So thank you very much. Everybody has cooperated. I thank my panelists. Finally, I thank the organizers, Balipara Foundation, for giving us this opportunity to talk about this. Thank you very much.